nothing like being on a good horse or seeing a good horse just get down and inhale a barrel. That's the love that keeps me driving with this industry. I truly love the sport.
She's a blue jean baby with her hat down low, chasing that wild wind wherever it blows, flying through the night just as fast as she can go. Yeah, it's one right, two left, riding like hell round a cloverleaf pattern that you know so well. Sitting just right with the reins in her hands underneath the bright lights, chasing them cans. She's one of those nobody knows out making some noise. Yeah, she's a dark horse.
Make your run, honey.
Fina! Come on, Al! Come on! Come on, come on, come on!
Barrel racing. I have always been around like rodeo and all of that because it comes from both sides of my family. But barrel racing, I never really got around to until about 4 years ago. I went to Northside one night, the Stockyards Cowtown Coliseum in Fort Worth, Texas, and I just saw barrel racing and I had never really asked about it before. And then my mom just kind of asked me about it and I was like, I like that. So I ended up getting into barrel racing and I've been doing it for 3 years now. And the minute I started doing it, I fell in love with it. I was like, this is all I want to do. So yeah, that's how I got into it.
Well, Corky and I got started putting on barrel races. Basically, we got put in business by a man. Stop. It's going to make me cry.
Okay.
By a man called Buzz Post. He's a really good friend of ours and gave us an opportunity. And we went to him and asked him for some added money. 96, I worked for him 4 or 5 years and started managing his ranch. And over dinner one night, I suggested, hey, let's have a barrel race and just ask, you know, for $1,500, $2,000. And we'd call it a Buzz Post and sell cars and do whatever. And of course, Buzz did nothing small. He gave us a lot more money than that. And we went to Glen Rose. It put on, added 5,000 in one day. And that was a world record that had never been done. A couple days before the race, I went to him and said, I think I steered you wrong. We don't have very many entries. Of course, I didn't realize you get them all the last day. We ended up with 749. That was the largest barrel race to that time, you know, up to that time, that had ever been held. And that's what set us on the barrel racing producers course, because that certainly wasn't anything that I had ever planned in my life. It was such a success, that first race. Of course, it excited us, you know, made us, boy, we were ready to roll. And we came back the next year and did three, and they got bigger and bigger. I remember Florence Urie telling me one time that she'd heard about 1,000-head barrel races her whole life and had never seen one. And I told her, I said, you watch, I'll make it happen.
My dad and my mom took me to a rodeo. It was a little 4-H rodeo, though it was tiny. And they saw all these girls on horses and they saw them barrel racing, and I was probably 4. And they said, that's what I want Shay to do. So my parents don't come from a rodeo family or ride horses or anything. My mom showed horses and my dad just worked on a ranch. So the whole rodeo thing is new. My dad pretty much taught me from a book on how to ride and how to barrel race. And at the time he said, no saddle horn. So I went to all these bareback classes and tried all this. And then finally, I went to a clinic and they were like, she has to use her saddle horn. What are you talking about? Don't use your saddle horn. So it's just kind of funny how, you know, he thought he knew, and but he's done a pretty good job. I mean, I've been pretty successful at what I've been doing.
When the BBR was formed, Robin and Ross and Steve, and they were all working at putting this association together, and they brought in producers from different parts of the country that were at the top of the game, reputable, however you want to put it. Steve and Ross were holding Oklahoma real well. We held Texas really well. The different partners, D&G was with us back then. You know, they were all over the place, and you know, that's kind of the epitome of a good barrel race, you know, in my opinion.
BBR over the last 5 years has grown tremendously. This year we were pretty stable with the last, with the previous year, but up until then we had undergone almost 15-20% growth on an annual basis. The finals is up around 1,800 contestants in the main race. But then when you add in the youth and the new member non-qualifier, the futurity and stuff, we had almost 5,000 runs this past finals. Paid out over $650,000 at the finals. Sold 2,500 horses there. So, you know, talk about Oklahoma City and the facility there. I don't know that there's another facility that can handle that. We run three arenas for 3 days simultaneously. It's really a coordination miracle that we are able to pull it off. We've got notes all over the computer screens as to when people draw up, if they're on this day and they're entered in this, and you know, there's a lot of coordination just getting the draws where they're not running in two barns at the same time.
I'm a very heavy sleeper. So Robin called about 5:15 in the morning to see if we were awake. We weren't. And she told me the electricity had gone off in our hotel. And so I kind of made a couple phone calls to some close friends who I knew would be up at that hour to see what local news was saying, since we didn't have electricity, and figured out that the worst had passed us, but that we were pretty much close to the epicenter of where probably the worst of the winds had hit. So we hurried and got ready and went out to the fairgrounds.
I guess I went to sleep, crawled in bed, I guess, around midnight. And then the wind kind of picked up about 1:30. And by 2 o'clock, I heard the petitions in my trailer. They're spring loaded, like slamming back and forth. And I, you know, honestly thought it was just something wind related. I didn't think it was going to be a huge storm. And by 4:45, it was full effect. And I guess by 5:15, a friend of mine, James Barnes, had called me and said, let's, you know, we need to get out of here. Something's going on. And I jumped out of my trailer, and little did I know, the power line was laid across the top of my trailer and my truck. And I jumped in the truck and literally pulled out from under it, because it was raining so hard and the wind was blowing so hard, you couldn't see anything. And the freight liner across the back of it started blowing the horn, telling me to stop. And so I jumped out of the truck and got in the truck with him, and we went back up to the front of the Coliseum to get out of it and take cover. But it was pretty western.
About 5:45 this morning, there were jeans laying everywhere. So everything got wet, got dirty. You know, not bad, but you know, something that a typical cowgirl would do to their jeans anyway, right? So. We just made the best out of it, and as you can see, everybody's having a great time. We are clearing them out. We have a storm sail, so it is what it is. You just make the best of it. And I'm just glad that everybody's okay and nobody got hurt and all the horses are good here. So, you know, it happens.
I guess in the 14 years that we've been doing the BBR finals, we've been really blessed, you know, not to have any really bad weather. But this year was the first year that we had a situation where it really impacted the contestants on a level at the event, and it impacted the event where we had to go to a plan B and change the format. And that was the most nerve-wracking thing I think I've ever been through.
You know, our main concern was to get there and make sure the contestants and their horses were okay.
So we got a phone call about 11:30 from Bill Allen at the fairgrounds, and he said that optimally that the electricity would be on between 1 and 4 o'clock that afternoon. We got together in a very dark back room. It was Robin, Destry and Corky, Charlene, Steve and I, and we tried to figure out what to do next because we knew now we at least had a time frame. And so we thought, you know, potentially if it comes on as late as 3 or 4 o'clock, we could pull an all-nighter and try and get everything done, you know, and keep everything as smooth as possible, but get everything fit in. But we also knew that at 4 o'clock, we were pushing the spot of no return, that we couldn't get everything done in time to even have the short go. So we just had to wait. So between 1 and 4, you know, we kept tabs, sitting in the office, any flicker of electricity, but it never came back on. And then about 3, probably 4 o'clock, we got the phone call. We had to make a decision what to do, but we also got another phone call from Bill saying that wasn't coming on then, but they knew it'd be on by the next day. And that's when we knew that we had to decide to cancel Saturday and come up with or announce what we had decided to do with the aggregate for the awards. It wasn't that I was never concerned, because it's always a concern, but there was a piece about a lot of the decisions that we made that it just was the right thing to do. We handled it in the best manner that we could, and given everything else, we have such a wonderful team that it was never how to do it was never in question, because I knew that we would come up with the best decision.
I had never been to anything this big whenever I first came to BBR Worlds, which was 2 years ago, whenever I did first get bags. And showing up was crazy because there's tons of different barns. They're all labeled with different letters. I mean, I had never been to anything this big, and this was only a year after I started barrel racing, so I was like, wow. And then the amount of people that were in it was insane. I was like, how do they do this many? And they divided it up, they run both rounds at the same time, so it's kind of like overwhelming. So the first time I came, my first time to run in one of the rounds, I had to just stay calm and just think about that I was running like a jackpot or something, and not think about the money that was behind it or the amount of people that were watching or whatever it was. I just had to stay calm, and because if I calm my nerves and my horse's nerves are calm. But the first time I came, it was overwhelming, but it was really fun. And I have been for 2 years in a row now, and I love it. I love big races like this.
Corky is probably one of the hardest working in our group. He has a full-time day job, but he is kind of he's the thing that keeps us grounded. He is the person that doesn't let us just get too wild with our imagination. He always has the voice of reason. He's very practical. I can't say enough good things about Corky. Probably the hardest aspect of my job, or the thing that I think is the hardest, is knowing like how much love and how much work goes into what we do. And sometimes when all you hear is the negative is the lack of appreciation. You know,
Destry hit on the fact that, I mean, none of us are getting rich doing this. We do it because we love the industry. We do it because we're passionate about it. We try to continuously challenge ourselves to reinvent BBR so that we stay ahead of the curve. One of our theories is that if you're not moving forward, you're falling behind. And so we're constantly trying to keep BBR fresh and new without changing the structure or the rules that we've had in place for as long as we have, because that's been the key element for the success of the company. But I think that that's probably the hardest part for me, is just that perception of knowing that the people that appreciate you the most are the ones that don't usually say anything. It's the ones, the negative stuff that you hear, you know, and just you have to let it roll off your back and get broad shoulders and just say, you know what, that doesn't faze me.
You know, we've been doing this for, well, next year's finals will be our 15th. And in that time, we have went up very seldom on our fees. We work really hard to keep our fees down, and that is difficult when you're trying to juggle so many balls and give them the best payout that you can and the most prizes, because all that stuff keeps going up and we keep fighting to keep our fees down. But I think that's why the company's been successful.
Well, this is my first year here at the BBR, and I was a little worried because I know that there is 1,000 people here, over 1,000 people, and I didn't really know how it was all going to be ran. And so when I pulled in, everything was so smooth. Everything went smoothly. My stalls were already set up, which I was so grateful for, and everything's just gone so smoothly, and I couldn't be more grateful for that, because when you get here and it's a wreck, it kind of puts you in a little stress stressed. So I've really appreciated all of it, and the ground's great here.
From a contestant standpoint, being BBR approved gives the contestants a, you know, kind of a set of standards that we know that they can expect when they go to a race. We only approve producers that hopefully have a good reputation, so, you know, they've got something established, but more so than that, we know that they're gonna pay out a certain way. They're gonna pay at least 75%. They're not gonna have a whole bunch of extra fees tacked on. You know, one of the things about BBR, and this is what Robin works so hard at, is added money for BBR shows comes from sponsorships. It doesn't come from contestants paying it over the course of a year or what have you. You've got, you know, that's where we, as a team, work a lot into that, and that's what the contestants can count on when they go to a BBR show.
The American kind of came about in an unusual way. It was totally unexpected. I had gotten a couple of phone calls from somebody I didn't know, and it was Riley Lambert, and I hadn't had a chance to call him back, and he didn't really give me a lot of information when he left a message, and so I wasn't in a big hurry to call him back. And then one day he called, and I actually answered the telephone, and I talked to him in person, and he kind of told me a little bit about what it was, and he introduced us to Randy Bernard, and ended up getting on the phone with Randy and Riley one day, and they, you know, gave me the scenario of what, you know, Randy's vision was for the American, and I was excited about it. I thought, wow, that's really cool, and went back to my partners and said, you know, we've been this group has reached out to us from RFDTV and has proposed, you know, that we be the sanctioning body for the barrel racing, and so we sat down and talked about it, and it gave us a lot of opportunity to add depth to what the association was and would be a great marriage. It would allow us to bring the rodeo atmosphere to the jackpot, which is something we've always tried to create. It would also create a situation where it should make our association probably have more of the 1D futurity trainer, pro rodeo contestant in our membership than any other association, which would create a really cool scenario for sweepstakes type competition. And that's kind of where we went with how we developed the qualifier system for our events, you know, for our sanctioned events. The 2017 American was the epitome of what we've been trying to do for the last 3 years, was to get a qualifier to the American Rodeo that actually won the American barrel racing competition and get a piece of that $1 million phone his purse. And it's just a Cinderella story, not necessarily because of who the qualifier was, but just from the standpoint that, you know, somebody received the richest barrel racing check ever in the history of barrel racing. We actually got to be a part of that. It's just so exciting.
We've paid out $63 million. BBR members made 99,000 runs last year. Those are pretty overwhelming and humbling numbers for me. And, you know, I never thought I would see anything this big. And it makes me just want to be better than we even are right now and get it bigger and bigger and bigger. The old saying is you've got to risk it to get the biscuit. And for barrel racers, that biscuit's in Oklahoma City at BBR.